Good morning, everyone. Welcome to the new church at Boulder Valley. My name's David. Thanks for joining us, and thanks for you who are with us online. Good to have you with us as well. We're continuing our series on Come and See the Life, Healings, and Miracles of Jesus Christ, and hope that will be helpful as we prepare for Easter, which will be here before we know it. So let's start with a short prayer, if we might, if we can bow our heads for a moment. Dear Lord, as we gather together today, we ask for you to bless us, bless our choice to be here today, bless our understanding as we hear your word and our hearts that we may be stirred to live a little differently because of hearing what you teach. We ask you to help us to be connected with each other, help us to open our hearts and our hands to each other that we may love one another as you have loved us. Amen.
How fickle my heart and how woozy my eyes. I struggle to find any truth in your lies. And now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Lend me your hand and we'll conquer them all. But lend me your heart and I'll just let you fall. Lend me your eyes, will change what you see. But your soul you must keep totally free. Har, 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 har. Awake, my soul. Fickle my heart and how woozy my eyes. I struggle to find any truth in your lies. And now my heart struggles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Har, 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 har. In these bodies we will live, in these bodies we will die, where you invest your love, you invest your life. In these bodies we will live, in these bodies we will die, and where you invest your love, you invest your life. Thank you.
on page 130. Sanctuary, page 130.
Come unto me, all you who labor and are heavy laden, and I will give you rest. Take my yoke upon you and learn of me, for I am gentle and lowly in heart, and you will find rest for your souls, for my yoke is easy and my burden is light. Amen. Oh, come, let us worship and bow down. Let us kneel before the Lord, our Maker. Lord, our Creator and God, we come before you today, the source and fountain of life. We ask you to teach us your ways, show us your paths, and inspire us to walk in them. Help us to take honest assessment of where we are in our spiritual life. Be brave, help us to be brave and honest, and see where it is that we are misaligned with what you teach and with what's good and true. And give us the courage to do what's right, to turn from those things and find peace in pathways that lead to you. Thank you, Lord, for this time in your presence. We pray that you bless this day and our lives and our families. Amen. Our Father, who art in the heavens, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, as in heaven, so upon the earth. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we also forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. O Lord, forgive us our trespasses.
As we forgive those who trespass against us.
Amen. You all be seated for a reading and talk for the children. And any children that want to come forward, you are welcome to do that. All right, we have a couple of volunteers. Good morning. So as you know, perhaps we've been talking about the life of the Lord Jesus Christ after he was born, right at Christmas time. We talked about that, and now we're talking about his life as we prepare for Easter to come. So one of the things that we're going to talk about today is how the Lord taught. And there's a way that we're told that he taught that was unique to him. And this is the only way he said that he taught. He taught in parables. Do you know what a parable is? Have you heard that word before? Okay. Well, a parable is like a story that has a special meaning in it for our lives. So it's teaching us something about how to live. So when the Lord taught something, he taught in ways that we listen to the story and go, even those stories about maybe the sower, where the sower would go off and he'd plant seeds or cast seeds into the ground, the Lord is actually telling us something about our spirit, about our hearts, our minds, and our spiritual life, okay? So today's story is a parable that he's going to tell us about talents. And have you ever heard the word talent before? Mm-hmm. Yeah? Do you know what that means? Do you have any idea what that means? Something that you can do, something that's special to you maybe, okay? Do you guys have talents? Of course you do. You have talents. Do you have talents? Yeah, okay. Well, everybody has talents. That's one of the things that's interesting because sometimes we look at certain types of people and go, oh, those people are talented. They have talents. Like this is a big football weekend, so people are probably looking at all those players and going, that person is so special and so talented. And they are, because they do a lot of, they've worked very hard to get where they are, but that's not the only thing, right? There's all kinds of different talents that people can have. And whatever it is that you have, the Lord's given you talents. Whether you see what they are yet or not is the question, but the Lord has given you talents, and he's going to ask you to use those gifts and those talents to love people and to serve them, okay? So this story is about a master who had some servants, and he gave them different amounts of talents. And some of them used them well, and one of them didn't at all. He just sort of he buried it in the ground. Which, is that a useful thing to do, you think? Probably not. All right, well, let's read the story. It says, and the Lord is saying, he's comparing, he's saying, the kingdom of heaven is like this. So do you know what heaven is like? This is a story that the Lord's going to tell us to help us to know what it's like in heaven, or what kinds of things that we could do to become angels in heaven. So the kingdom of heaven is like a man traveling to a far country who called his own servants and delivered his goods to them. And to one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to each according to his own ability. And immediately he went on a journey. So the man gave them these talents. So he gave him a bag of talents. Here, you can have those ones, and you can have those ones. All right. He gave them to him, and he went off on a journey. Then he who had received the 5 talents went and traded with them and made another 5 talents. So then you worked very hard. Here, you get 5 more. You made 4 or 5 more, okay? And likewise, he who had received 2 gained 2 more also. So good job. You also worked on yours. But he who had received 1 went and dug it in the ground. So let's say this person got 1 talent and they just said, well, I'm just going to. No one can see it, okay? Keep it safe under there, okay? All right. But he who had received 1 went and dug in the ground, and he hid his Lord's money. After a long time, the Lord of those servants came and settled accounts with them. So he who had received 5 talents came and brought five other talents, saying, Lord, you delivered to me 5 talents, and look, I have gained 5 more talents besides them. And his Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You were faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. He also had received 2 talents, came and said, Lord, you delivered to me 2 talents, and look, I have gained 2 more talents besides them. His Lord said to him, well done, good and faithful servant. You have been faithful over a few things. I will make you ruler over many things. Enter into the joy of your Lord. Then he who had received the 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew you to be a hard man, reaping where you have not sown and gathering where you have not scattered seed. And I was afraid, and I went and hid your talent in the ground. And look, there you have what is yours. But his Lord answered and said to him, you wicked and lazy servant, you knew that I reap where I have not sown and gather where I have not scattered seed. So you ought to have deposited my money with the bankers, and at my coming I would have received back my own with interest. So take the talent from him and give it to him who has 10 talents. For to everyone who has more will be given, and he who will have abundance. But from him who does not have, even what he has will be taken away. So in the story, there the person that had five talents. That was you. You got five talents, and you went, and you worked hard, and you invested them, and you got five more, just like that. And you got two, and you worked hard, and you got two more. And then there was the wicked and lazy servant who hid his in the ground. And he came back and said, Lord, I was afraid, so I just hid it in the ground. And what did they do with those talents? They gave it to you because you worked hard. Does that seem right? Does that seem fair? Yeah? Are you cool with that? All right, good. Well, the Lord is trying to tell us something important about our life. And our life is supposed to be one of usefulness. We're supposed to take the gifts that the Lord gives us, the things that we know to be true and the things that we know to be good, and we're supposed to practice them and do them. If we just figure, you know, it's really just about me learning what's true, and then I'm just going to take what's true and I'm just going to bury it, and I'm never going to do anything with it. The Lord's like, that's not what it's about. We're supposed to take what we have and share it and help it to grow. And so the kingdom of heaven is like that. The more that you give, the more that you do, the more that you learn, the more that you share, the more that you get. So if you want to help other people to be happy in your life, guess what? You're going to be happier and happier too, because it just keeps coming back to you. That's what heaven is like. But if we just go, well, I'm not going to share anything I have, I'm just going to keep it all to myself all the time, we kind of become miserable, actually, in that we everything that we have that the Lord's given us is actually taken from us instead of growing. So you all have talents that the Lord's given you, and you're going to grow them as you live your life. And as you think about it, think about how can I use what the Lord's given me, the things I love to do, to help other people be happy, okay? Because then when you do that, you're going to get more and more and more, right? Do you guys want to keep those? You can if you want to. Okay. Well, thank you. I appreciate you listening this morning. We're going to go and sing our next song.
Please stand as we sing This Little Light of Mine on page 165.
This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. I don't care what others say, I'm gonna let it shine. Shine. I don't care what others say, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Hide it under a bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, hide it under a bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine. Hide it under a bushel, no, I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine. Let it shine, shining all around the world. I'm gonna let it shine, oh, shining all around the world. I'm gonna let it shine, shining all around the world. I'm gonna let it shine, let it shine, let it shine, let it shine. Don't let anyone blow. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Oh, this little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. This little light of mine, I'm gonna let it shine. Let it shine, let it shine, let it shine.
I invite you to bow your heads for a blessing on the children. May the Lord give his angels charge over you to keep you in all of your ways. Amen. I invite the children to go to their program and we'll sing our next song.
On page 115, Only in God, page 115.
Screen will be shared by Andrea. Thank you. Final reading are from the Heavenly Doctrine for the New Church, first from True Christianity, then Divine Providence. The human mind is made up of the understanding and the will. It is the function of the understanding to think and of the will to act. So long as our acknowledgement is merely in thought on the part of the understanding, we approach the Lord with no more than half of our mind. But when we act, then we do so with our whole mind, and that is what believing is. We ought to purify ourselves of evils and not wait for the Lord to do this for us directly, as can be seen by comparison with a servant coming in with his face enclosed filthy with soot and dung, and going up to his master and saying, "Please wash me, sir." Would not his master say to him, "What do you mean, you fool? Here are water, soap, and a towel. Haven't you got hands and the ability to use them? Wash yourself." So the Lord God will say, "The means of purification I have given you, and your will and ability also are given by me. So use these gifts and talents of mine as if they were yours, and you will be purified," and so on. Unless we seem to be managing everything that has to do with our occupation in our lives by our own prudence, we could not be led and managed by divine providence. It would be as though we stood there with our hands hanging limp, mouths open, eyes closed, holding our breath and waiting for something to flow into us. If you want to be led by divine providence, use your prudence as a servant, an employee who faithfully manages the employer's assets. Prudence is the talent that was given to servants for business purposes with an accounting required. Amen. Here in our lessons, and blessed are they who hear the word of God and keep it. Amen.
Spend all your time waiting for that second chance, for a break that would make it okay. There's always some reason to feel not good enough, and it's hard at the end of the day. I need some distraction. That brings me to
Let the words of my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, my rock and my redeemer. Amen. So I'm going to ask you to change your mind today. I'm going to ask you to examine yourself and try to understand why you are where you are in your spiritual life. And I'm going to ask you also where to change where you are and how you live your life. Is that cool? Not too much to ask? Maybe a little bit. But in all honesty, why bother coming here or watching online if you're not planning to change your life, right? And I hope you want to be challenged. I hope you want to be challenged to live differently. And I look at today two stories from the Word about the Lord, about his teachings and his actions, bearing in mind the invitation that this series is called, Come and See. An invitation for us to learn from the Lord and reflect on our own lives in the light of his Word, in the light of these teachings, his healings, the things he says and does. Because these stories are given to us, they're mirrors for our own spiritual life. They reflect things about us that we need to recognize and things we can do to live a bit differently. And most importantly, they show the power that the Lord has to help us, to move us, to give us an opportunity for real change if we're willing to do that. So the invitation is come and see. Come and see if something can't be different because of hearing what the Lord says or the things that he asks us to do. So the first story is the story of the Pool of Bethesda, where there's this pool outside of Jerusalem, it says by the Sheep Gate, a place where people would come and go as kind of a crossing place, and there's this pool there, and there's a celebration in Jerusalem. So there's this all these people outside this pool lying there waiting for something to happen, because this pool is special. It's different in that every once in a while, an angel would come and stir the waters, and the first person that could get in the water would be healed of whatever ailment they had. And so here they are outside Jerusalem. They can hear the celebration going on, but they are at this pool and probably not a very happy state. But into this place, the Lord shows up and he sees this man and he asks him this question, do you want to be made well? Do you want to be made well? And of course, he says, well, I don't have anyone to put me in the pool. And when it stirs up, people always get there first. And he says, rise, take up your bed and walk. And he's able to do that after all this time. So this story, in a real way, pictures when we're stuck, not able to stop a certain behavior or change a habit that we have. And I think sometimes we just don't know we're stuck or how stuck we really are. Because if we did, we probably would do something about it, right? We'd probably want to make a change. Sometimes other people see it in us. They see how stuck we can be. And we can remain somewhat oblivious at times, but sometimes we do know. And we can feel helpless too and feel powerless to do anything about it. Like in this story illustrates, we can spend a lot of time being stuck before help comes along, before some sort of situation or solution is shown to us that can help us to be different. But before we're willing to try something different, often we live out the definition of insanity, doing the same thing over and over again, expecting things to be different, expecting different results. So this man had been there for 38 years. Think about that. He'd been sitting by this pool for 38 years, waiting and hoping that he could be the one that could get into this pool and be healed of this ailment. Now, it seems crazy to me. You look at it and go, what an idiot. Why was he there for so long, right? What's wrong with him? Couldn't he come up with a different strategy after 38 years? Maybe just be in the pool the whole time or something, right? But how am I like him? How do I do the same thing? Where in my life am I stuck, repeating the same mistakes over and over again? And like in the story of the defenders of our position, our rationality, our reasons and excuses are all there. We probably all have them. We have our reasons why this hasn't changed for us. We have our excuses why I can't do it or why it's too hard. And he says, well, someone always gets in there first. There's no one to put me in the pool. So think about the setting there. There's a celebration. There's a feast in Jerusalem, right within earshot of where this pool is. Jerusalem, the name Jerusalem means a place or an abode of peace. So it's right near a place of peace, but not able to enjoy it, not able to be part of that. So that pictures, too, how the church or heaven in us, that we're not quite there, we're not feeling it yet, we're not there, we're not at celebration, we're not at a state of peace, but we're at this pool, at the sheep gate where the sheep go in and out. So you think about it, we're not on the inside yet, we're sort of at the outside, we're at the crossroads, but it's a place of transition, and that's good, that's positive, where we can move from one place to another. So that's not all bad, because that does mean what the story is implying is that change is possible. And all of us, I would say, are all works in progress, right? We're all angels in training. We're all here to try to figure out how to be differently, live differently than we do. But we're not in that place of celebration, that place of peace yet. So it's kind of a sad scene. And it says that there lay a great multitude of sick people, blind, lame, and paralyzed. So all around are these people not quite in there. Of course, we think of that story and we go, well, this story is actually about me. It's not think about anybody else. What is it in myself where I'm stuck, where I have an inability to move forward, where I'm suffering in some way, feeling like I'm on the outside or feel like I'm not in a state of peace yet? Where have I messed up? Where have I cutting myself off from connection with the Lord? Where is that place in me that's keeping me from having a heavenly experience? If we recognize that in us, that should be somewhat upsetting to us, right? That there's a happier way of life that I could be living, but I'm not there. I'm sort of on the outside looking in. And we know there's a better way. We can hear the celebration. We're within earshot of Jerusalem. We can feel the vibe, perhaps, of what's happening there, but we're also not feeling like we're there yet. We're stuck at this pool, waiting for something to change, waiting for our opportunity. So think about that in relation to ourselves. How often do we find ourselves sitting there going, well, I'm not there, I can't be there, I can't fix this, I can't change this. So the first error I want to point out in this thinking is that we're waiting for something to happen. Do we spend our spiritual life waiting for some circumstance to occur so that we can make a change? Well, I can't do it yet because so-and-so, because such-and-such. We sort of put our all eggs in this one basket, this sort of if-then thinking. Well, if this happens, then I could do it. Like changing, waiting for a change of heart. Like, I really want to wait till I really want to do it, and then I'll do it. Like, well, guess what? If you sit there and wait for you to really want to do it, it's not going to happen. The Lord says that's not how it works. We have to identify that we want to change, and we have to compel ourselves to make the change against our own will, really. So 38 years watching and waiting. So the first error is that waiting for something else to happen. The second error is relying on excuses. I have no one to put me in the pool. Someone always gets there first. And there's lots of them available. I'm sure that you know the excuses that are good, that you're good at coming up with in your own life. Like, they're right at hand. We can conjure up all kinds of them. And if you don't have any, just look around you. Some people say, well, my issues are unique. You know, I have a unique circumstance. Like, of course you do. We all do. But doesn't mean you can't change it. Or but look around you, there's war in the world, there's unrest in the world, there's political divide, think about all the economic issues that we're dealing with, how busy I am, opportunities don't come my way, I'm not a lucky person, you know. So how am I supposed to rise above it? Stuckness, when we're feeling stuck, means that our defenses and our rationalizations are winning the battle at the moment. So we're letting those things win instead of overriding them or moving past them. So where this is all occurring is at the Pool of Bethesda. The name Bethesda means house of mercy. So mercy is love grieving. It wants to help. It wants to be there and has compassion for other people. And that pictures that the Lord cares about our situation. The Lord cares very much for us. And that's why literally the Lord shows up in the story. He shows that the Lord is there for us when we're ready. I mean, the Lord is, as the teachings say, is always urging, pressing, trying to be received by us. Behold, I stand at the door and knock. I'm trying to get your attention. I'm trying. But the Lord has to wait for us to open the door, has to wait for us to be willing to let him in. But there we are waiting for the stirring of the water. So the pool of water in this story pictures our outer mind that has all this knowledge or data or truth in it. This our mind is like a pool that collects information, collects truths, collects doctrine in it, which is great. But it doesn't bring any change unless it's stirred up in some way. So we can be in that mindset of, well, I have the information, I have the truth. We've got all these books. Look at all these books we have on our shelf. We have so many teachings, right? I've got them. But it doesn't mean anything unless we're stirred or we do something about it. Truth by itself will not affect change. Well, the Lord shows up when we're ready. When we're ready, when we're willing. And it feels sometimes for us, we're safer. We feel safer on our porch, hanging out by the pool. It's comfortable there. We know what life is like. The devil you know is better than the devil you don't know, right? There's a certain comfort even in our own dysfunctions. We might even say, yeah, I know I have this issue, but I'm used to it. It's comfortable to me. You're asking me to put that away. That's scary. But I think also with the increase in consumption of social media and media, there's an increase in fear in a lot of people's lives because there's so much we know about so many bad things that are going on. It's like the world is really scary. I'll just stay right here by the pool and everything will be fine. So maybe we're less inclined to take a risk, to do something differently, especially when the world around us doesn't feel safe and feels unstable. But the Lord has a way of piercing through all of this with this penetrating question, which is really hard to dodge, this question, do you want to be made well? The Lord is asking all of us that question, do you want to be made well? How would you answer that question posed to you? How do you want to be made well? I don't think we can answer no. That wouldn't be honest. We can behave like our answer is no. I have no one to put me in the pool, and someone always gets there first. Well, don't believe everything that you think. So like the person described in that passage, Divine Providence, like hanging our hands down with our mouths agape, waiting for influx, like, okay, Lord, make it happen. I'm ready. This is my spiritual strategy. I'm just going to, all right. Looks pretty ineffective, right? The Lord says that's not how it works. It's like that person, the servant coming into his master and saying, wash me. Look how dirty I am. Can't you? And he says, you fool, look, you have a towel, you have water, you have soap. You have everything that you need. You just got to use it. We just need to use what we've been given. So we need our prudence. And that's where the story of the talents comes in. I said we're going to talk about two different stories. The prudence is the talent. It's the good judgment. It's the making wise decisions, that those abilities that the Lord has given us. And it says the Lord gives everyone talents, gives everyone an ability and potential to do amazing things or even just small things. But they're there to use. We've got to do them. Things that are more in alignment with our heavenly way of life. But we may be mistaken and think, well, the best thing to do is kind of bury it in the ground, like just hide it, because I don't want anything bad to happen to it. But we have to focus on using what we know. And when we do that, the Lord can infill it. Notice in the story, the one who uses their talents and gets more talents gets even more talents. They get the one that the person had buried. That's what heaven is like. The more that you give, the more that you do, the more it comes back to you. If we have that scarcity mindset, everything becomes less and less. It's like exercise. When we do it, when we actually do it consistently, we actually get stronger. Our bodies get stronger. We get more healthy. And we might have to force ourselves to do it. And we might have to force ourselves to do it for a while. But the more we do that, at some point, there's a turning point where we actually have to force ourselves not to do it because it becomes part of who we are. That's the difference we're talking about. Do it and do it and do it, and the Lord will give you a heart for it in time. Lord comes up to him, doesn't even forget about the pool. Pool, don't worry about the pool. Don't worry about it. Arise, take up your bed, and walk. You have what you need. The bed pictures our doctrinal knowledge, our understanding of truth. We all have a belief system, is what it pictures. You all have one. You just got to use it. You've got to pick it up and take it and go forward. A little step at a time, and things will change. And the man was healed, was just standing up and going. Such a simple story, yet so profound. It's like The Lord's not going to do some amazing thing. He's just going to say, well, just you've got what you need. Just pick it up and go. One little bit at a time. And the day was the Sabbath day. Pictures that it's the Lord. The Lord alone is the one that regenerates us, that actually does the work, that gives us the ability to do anything. It's done by the Lord and through us. We are vessels through which the Lord acts. But if we are unwilling to use the vessel, the Lord can't flow into the vessel. So we have to act as if it all depends upon us, acknowledging at the same time that it all depends upon the Lord. That's an interesting dance that we play, but that's how we're supposed to live. So the parable of the talents is a man traveling to a far country, and he gives his talents to his servants. It pictures the freedom we have. The Lord gives us the gifts, and it feels like he went away to a far country. It's like, all right, I'm over here, way over there. You have been given these things. Now live your life. Live as you wish. Use the gifts I've given you according to your ability. And we all have different capacities for good and truth. The talents actually picture each of us have different amounts of good and truth that we're given by the Lord. We get what we need. We have exactly what we need. Don't compare yours with somebody else's. That's not necessary. But the Lord's saying, you have what you need. But the important factor is, do we put it to use? And we're asked to use our prudence, which is our discernment, our ability to make decisions, like what's appropriate here. The Lord gives us that ability. He says, I want you to use that. I want you to make those decisions and do something. Use your talents. You don't have to be self-effacing about your talents. You know, it's easy for us to pretend to be humble, like, oh, no, I'm not good at that. If the Lord has given you a talent, be grateful for it, give the Lord thanks for it, and just embrace it and use it as a gift. Not to make yourself shine, but let the Lord shine. That you might glorify your Father who is in heaven, as it says. There's all kinds of talents. Like, we sometimes think, oh, the people that have those ones that are more visible, or oh, they have all the talents. Like, they have a type of talent that's more visible, sure, but you have talents too that are less visible, perhaps. Maybe you work with your hands, or you work with music or art or computer programming that no one ever gets to see how that all is behind the scenes, but it works and it's a miracle. Maybe you're good with finances or math or science or mechanics, or you're a therapist, you work in healthcare, or business. Maybe you're good at baking or banking or real estate or parenting. Maybe you're good at coming up with ideas. Maybe you're good at implementing ideas. Maybe you're just good, tell me what to do and I'll do it. That's your talent. You don't want to be the one that thinks about it. But heaven is a kingdom of useful service. It's in this world where we learn what heaven is like by practicing it and doing it. And we all have the ability to be angels of heaven, to be loving, be kind, to be caring, to be spiritual people here on earth. We need to let go of the belief that we can't. The Lord will help us if we will rise, take up our bed, and walk. I bet you know what you need to do to get on the path of your spiritual life. I bet you do. And the Lord is just saying, well, get up and do it. Do it. You've been given everything you need. Don't listen to the excuses. They're all there, of course. And we can feel overwhelmed sometimes, like I have so many things I need to deal with. I'm just a big, fat sinner. And the Lord's saying, well, it doesn't do you any good to be general like that. You've got to identify something. Just identify one thing and work on that. And if you do that with set purpose, I will help you to clear up the rest. Just pick one thing. Be specific. We all have talents. Don't bury them in the ground. And it's interesting that one servant believed, he said, well, I buried it because I believed you'd be harsh. I thought you were harsh and I was afraid of you. Picture that as your relationship to God, like, I'm afraid of you. I thought you were harsh, and so I'm just going to lay low and hope you don't see me. I'm saying that's not how you were meant to live. You're precious, you're important, you're talented, you're loved. The Lord is rooting for you. The Lord's your cheerleader. He's not trying to trip you up, not trying to trick you in any way. So I began by saying I was going to ask you to change your mind today. So here's how. I invite you to rethink where you might be thinking it's not possible, that there's no way out, that I can't change this, I can't achieve this. The Lord said, with God, all things are possible. Without me, you can do nothing, but with God, all things are possible. I also invited you a few weeks ago, perhaps, to a challenge to read the Word 2 chapters a day, starting with Matthew all the way get through Easter. I don't know if anyone's taken me up on that challenge, but the challenge remains. See what you can do. Fill your mind with an understanding of who the Lord is so you can have a better relationship, a stronger relationship. Know what the Lord is up to. Know what he's asking of you. Know that he's there. So the second thing I was going to ask you to do is to change how you live, to take up your bed and walk. So that invitation is to step into a belief that you have one step. If you believe that your relationship with your partner or someone that you care about is would be better if you did X, Y, or Z, then do X, or do Y, or do Z. Do that thing that you're thinking about. If you have that phrase in your head, I've always wanted to, well, do the thing that you've always wanted to do. Maybe set down the distractions. Put down some Netflix and Hulu and YouTube and news and all those things that, but there's so many good shows. Yeah, there are. That's true. But they'll still be there. Don't worry about it. Put them down and see if the Lord doesn't fill that space with something else. And feel the discomfort of that. Because sometimes those things mask our loneliness, they mask our fears, they help us to get through things, perhaps, or it feels that way. Maybe it's sorrow, maybe it's pain. Set it down, feel the discomfort, and do the next good thing that you know you need to do and begin to live differently. We have the talents. The Lord has given them to us. The Lord is with us as well. The Lord is there. And we'll stumble and fall, but we can also get up and try again. I love what C.S. Lewis writes. He says, after each failure, ask forgiveness. Pick yourself up and try again. Very often what God first helps us towards is not the virtue itself, but just the power of always trying again. So that's a victory, being, yeah, I fell, but I got up, and I tried again. The Lord gives power to the weak, and to those who have no might, the Lord increases strength. Even the youth shall faint and be weary, and the young men shall utterly fall. But those who wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and shall not faint. Amen. Would you bow your heads with me for a prayer? Lord, thank you for teaching all of us from your word the way to heaven and the way to happiness, both eternally and temporally as well. In order to really experience those, we need to make some choices and begin to think and live differently. Lord, help us to be brave and courageous in doing that and to choose one thing we can do differently this week and start to act on it, knowing that with that action, you can flow in with that invitation, you can be present. Thank you, Lord, for the sure knowledge that you are always there and that you love us. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious unto you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen. I invite you to stand for the closing of the word.
Please remain standing as we sing on page 132, Seek Only Thy Perfect Way.
I long to be able to enter your city and be near the living God, where even the sparrow can go and is welcome to nest among altars of love. O Lord of the heavens, my God and my King, teach me to live day by day. I want above all else to follow your footsteps and seek only thy perfect way. teach me to live day by day. I want above all else to follow your footsteps and seek only thy perfect way. I sing in the morning a song of thanksgiving for blessings he promised would be. Someday ascending, he calls to his city all those who in him have believed. O Lord of the heavens, my God and my King, teach me to live day by day. I want above all else to follow your footsteps and seek only
takes just